Greetings and blessings all the way from Germany, Munich to Zimbabwe, Harare. 25 years celebration, partnership between these two great cities, Munich and Harare. And I'm very thankful and feel blessed to be part of this show. And I hope many people listening in Africa, in Germany, and the rest of the world. I'm happy to be part of this one. You know, it's a difficult time for everybody. It's two great cities. I heard that in Harare now it's a lockdown again. So it's a difficult time in Harare, also difficult time all over the planet. It's just something happening through the pandemic, which is a kind of something, a new start for everybody, you could say, because, you know, that connects all the people on the planet, whether you are rich or poor. It's just connecting the people. Maybe it's the time for a new consciousness, a new thinking, you know. Maybe it's the end of the ego time and the beginning of love and togetherness. My name is Tormenta Jobarteh. I'm a choral player and storyteller. I'm born in Munich, but I grew up in the Gambia, West Africa, and I got adopted by a griot family. The griots are musicians and storytellers. In the Mande tradition, the tradition is called Jelia, and I am a Jeliba. And one of the most important instruments by the storytellers in the Gambia, West Africa, Mali, Senegal, Guinea, Guinea-Bissau, Burkina Faso, Ivory Coast, is this instrument is called kora. The kora is an instrument made out of a calabas. And it's covered with a cow skin. And through the calabas, you see here that stick with 21 rings. And to push the rings up and down, that's the way you tune the instrument. The instrument is played with forefinger, with your thumb and the index finger. The kora has also a meaning on every part. The calabas stands for the earth, and the cow skin stands for the animals, and this here symbolizes the backbone of a human being. And the first story I'm going to tell, it's one of my favorite stories. I like that story. It's an old Sufi story, and the story is called Two Wives. How sweet it is to have two wives, one man told his friend, as they were sitting in a little palm hut to drink a little palm wine. used the most beautiful words he described it. How sweet it is to have the taste of two different honey. The eyes of his friend became big and bigger. Yeah, my friend, he lives in a paradise. He can taste the honey of two different wives. Why, I myself, I should have a second wife. And after a while, he married a second wife. After the ceremony, when it was time to go to sleep, he wants to go to the bed of his new wife. But this one said, "Yeah, I don't want to be the third wheel of a car. And you know, I don't like your first wife. So now better you sleep to the bed of your first wife." So the man, he was trying to sleep at the bed of his first wife. But this one said, "Hey, if you marry the next one because I'm not good enough anymore for you, now better you go to this one." So the man had no other chance than to go to the mosque to find some rest. And as he was trying to fall asleep in a sleeping position, he heard a little harem, a little He turned around, and there were his friends sitting there, looking at him. And he said, "Hey, Baba, what you are doing here?" "Well, Keba, my two wives, they let me not sleep in their bed, and that goes on already for months." "Yeah? But why then you told me how sweet it is to have two wives?" "Hey, Baba, I was so lonely here in this mosque, and I wish to have a friend." Thank you. So, ladies and gentlemen, I have a surprise for you. Because, you know, we have somebody here from Harare, Zimbabwe, playing this beautiful instrument, Mbira. It's just like beautiful, like the kora. And it's one of the main instruments in Zimbabwe. And my good friend, all the way from Zimbabwe, Harare. And as they told me, I have to say, MUHAG! You know what that means? Greetings. And ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Vengai
Manyanga
in Mbira.
Yes.
MUHAG. Chaka.
Boom. Thank you so much.
You're welcome, brother.
Me and my friend Jobarteh know each other
long time.
Yes. But what we're doing today for you, it's a surprise. Nobody has done this.
Yes.
We are also improvising. Jobarteh didn't tell you. He was supposed to come here with his full band.
Yes.
But unfortunately, his band members are not there. Then he called me and said, "Can we manage to do something?" Then I said, "No, we can always come up with something."
Yes.
So I'm here to support Jobarteh,
the greatest
storyteller which I know from Munich. Thank you so much for inviting me.
Thank you. Yeah, that is just exactly what my brother here said, you know. And so now it's the first time we're doing this together, and we just had a little jam at the other room and checked out if everything works out, and I tell you, it works. Yeah, man.
Wait and see. Sit back.
Yeah, so the first story we're telling together, it's called Circle of 99.
The Circles of 99.
Mm-hmm.
Once upon a time, there was a king, a mighty one. He had a big land, as far as your eyes could see. All the land belonged to that king and his palace, beautiful palace. He had rooms filled up with gold and silver. Hey, this king, he was a rich king. Many, many people worked for the king, and he had his own personal servant. This man, his name was Alibaba. Alibaba was a very good human being. He had a big heart and a bright smile for everybody. And he had open ears for everybody. Alibaba was a very good human being. God was with him. I tell you that, my brother. Alibaba was a good human. Every day, Alibaba had to serve the breakfast to the king. And he had to walk a long floor to the chamber of the king with his golden tablet. And Alibaba, every day, he sing a song for his wife Fatu, because he loved his wife Fatu too much.
Very much.
Fatu yo, si jajalano. Fatu yo,
si jajalano.
Fatu yo, si jajalano.
Fatu yo, si jajalano.
Fatu, fai, fatu, fatu, kelema yo. Fatu yo,
si jajalano.
Fatu, fai, fatu, fatu, kelema yo. Fatu yo.
Fatu yo, si jajalano.
Fatu yo, si jajalano.
Fatu yo, si jajalano.
Fatu yo, si jajalano. Putu bele, putu bele, putu bele, putu bele, putu bele, putu bele. Oh ma misera, oh ma putu bele, oh ma misera, oh ma mica. Hey. Alibaba opened the door of the sleeping room and he put the golden tablet on the golden table and he opened the curtain, the windows, and with a bright smile he bent. So the king asked Alibaba, Alibaba, Namu, tell me the secret why you're always happy. Yeah, my king. That's not a secret. I have a beautiful wife. I have two children. I have a little house yourself gave it to me. Yeah, Alibaba. All these things are not the reason to be happy. Tell me the secret. Alibaba, you know, me, I'm able to torture you. Hey, my king. Alibaba bent with a bright smile and said, my king, there is no secret. And he left the room. After a while, the marabout of the king came into the room. His name was Lamin Sise. The family Sise, they were the marabout family on the king's palace for centuries. In question of humanity and justice and superstition. And the king asked his marabout, Moho, Namo, you know Alibaba, my personal surfer? Everybody knows Alibaba. Alibaba is a very good person. He always has a bright smile and he has a good heart. God is with Alibaba. Can you tell me why Alibaba is always happy. Well, my king, Alibaba does not belong to the circle of 99. He does not belong to the circle of 99. And this is enough to be happy? Well, my king, it's enough to be not unhappy.
Definitely.
I will show it to you on an example. Tonight, when it's sunset and it gets dark, you know, we meet at the main gate and bring a leather bag with 99 golden coins. And dress yourself up as a begging monk so the people cannot recognize you. Yeah, the king could not wait till the sun comes down. And then he prepared a leather bag with 99 golden coins. And then he went down to the gate. His marabout were waiting already there. And then they were going out to the city. Around the palace, all the rich people were living there. And they celebrate life, you know. They drink palm wine, beer, and they enjoy their women, you know, because rich people like to enjoy their money. Not so?
They have money.
And there was a big things happening and people celebrate life and, you know, they were happy. And then, slowly, on the edge of the city, all the poor people were living there. And there, it became dark. Because the poor people, as it says already, they have no money. And some of them not even having money to buy a candle. But there, on the house, the left side, there was a little house, and in this house, a candle were burning. And this was the house of Alibaba. Hey. So the marabout, he took the leather bag, and he walked softly and slowly, that nobody could hear him, to the door of Alibaba's house. And he put the leather bag on the doorknob. And then he went back to the bush where the king hided already himself. And so Alibaba heard something on his door. He went to the door, he opened it. He looked right side, he looked left side. He could not see nobody. But then suddenly, felt that leather bag in his hand and his heart start to pump because he knew something special is in this leather bag. He could not believe how it comes to his door, and he walked his 3 steps to the kitchen table and he emptied the leather bag. La ila 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 la. Ah, golden coins! And there's his wife started to count, you know.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, count. She made that little five coin terms, you know, so to count it more easy because it was plenty. So they counted 5, 10, 15, 20, 40, 50, 60, 65, 70, 80, 85, 90, 91, 92, 93, 94, 95, 96, 97, 99. Where's the 100? It has to be 100. It's impossible that it's just 99. It must be 100. Alibaba.
Suspicious.
So suspicious. 99 was a number nobody trusted, that number at that time. Alibaba looked at his wife. She crawling already under the table to look after this missing golden coin, but she could not find it. They searched the whole house. Alibaba went out to the door again. Maybe when he brought the bag in, maybe he dropped one, but no. So they sit down at the kitchen table and they start to discuss. And his wife said, well, maybe this year we are not buying anything for the children. Then maybe we can bring that one missing golden coin together. And Ali Baba said, maybe I should have a second work. So maybe then after 1 year or 2 years, maybe we would get that one missing golden coin together. And they were thinking and brainstorming, and you know, one golden coin, it was so much. It was just too much. And when the sun rises in the morning, and it was clear, whatever they would do, they would be never be able to bring that one golden coin together. At this day, Ali Baba served the breakfast as usually to the king. He walked a long floor, but at this day, he did not sing a song. He had a sour face. He opened the jamba door. He put the golden tablet on the golden table. He opened the curtain, the windows, and with a sour face, he bent. And he left the room. The king wondered. He never saw Ali Baba like that. After a while, the marabout came to the room. And the king asked his marabout, Moro, Namo, what's happened to Ali Baba? He seems to be not happy today, you know. He had a sour face. He did not sing a song for his wife. What's happened to Ali Baba? My king, Ali Baba belongs now to the circle of 99. Thank you, my brother. That was a beautiful guidance with the Mbira.
Thank you so much. Thank you, everybody.
MUHAG, he will come again. Yes, ladies and gentlemen, the next story I'm going to tell is an Anansi story. Anansi, the Spider-Man. He's very famous all over Africa. Everybody knows Anansi, the Spider-Man. Original, these stories are from Ghana. But Anansi stories spray out all over the world. And I'm sure even in Zimbabwe, many people know Anansi stories. Anansi, the wisdom of the Spider-Man. And this story starts with a big storm. The storm was over. There was a lot of rain. And you could see big holes filled up with water. And beside the holes, many, many, many frogs were sitting there. Suddenly the frogs, they saw a hunter. The hunter had his spear in his hand. And when the frogs saw the hunter, all of them were running away. on the right side, you saw a yams field. And this was the yams field of Anansi and his wife. Anansi was a hard, hard working guy. Every day he had to work too much. One night, he lay in his bed, he put his spider legs up in the air, he shaked his little butt. And he said to his wife, "I'm so tired from working. I'm so tired, my wife, and I think I will die soon. You know, and if I die, I have a last wish. Please, bury me in the middle of our yams field and put a stove there, oil, and a little oven. Because if there's a next world where I'm going, I like to enjoy my yams there." His wife was laughing. She said, "Anansi, nobody knows where we are going when we die. And you won't die. Tomorrow is the next day to work. Just to make you feel better, I will just promise you your last wish. I will do that. Okay? But now you sleep." Anansi fall asleep. So the next morning, a very unusual thing. One of his spider legs was just right, like posting out here on the right side, and the next one on the left side. His wife never saw that, and he did not move. She tried to shake him up, but what I should tell you, Anansi died. And so his wife and his two children were just going for his last wish and bury him right in the middle of the yams field. And I don't know if you remember what they put in. What they put in? A stove, a little oil, and what else? Who knows it? A oven, a stove, a pot. Right, a pot, oil, and a stove. And then they went home, crying for the rest of the day. Anansi is dead. Anansi died. Anansi died. Anansi died. But what should I tell you? Anansi did not die. He lied. He lied. He was tired from working, and he just pretended to be dead. In the night, he came out of his grave. He put his stove there. He put the pot. He put a little oil, and then he sliced his yams field in fine pieces, and he enjoyed himself every night. But his wife, she recognized that every day some yams were just disappearing from the field. How that can be possible? And she was a smart wife. She went to the store and she took out a gross gear. You know what is a gross gear? It's this thing what people put on the field so that the birds are not coming. So she put it in the middle of the field and she put on the gross gear, she put some glue on it. And then she went home. So this night, when Anansi came out of his grave, he saw somebody standing there on his field. Yeah? "Hey, you! Yes, you! Go away! This is my field! Acha!
Hey, you, go away!
But the grass girl were not moving. Now Anansi became really angry. And he ran to that grass girl, put his first spider leg and back kick in. What's happened? He stuck. He took the second one. He kicked in. What's happened? He stuck. The third, the fourth, the fifth, the sixth. Anansi was the only six-legged spider in the world. Because normal spider have how many legs? Exactly, eight. So Anansi was the only one with six. And he was just stuck on this grass care and he could not move anymore. The sun rise and he turned his little spider head backwards and he saw his wife coming over the field and he thought, oh my God, I guess I fall into the trap of my wife. And she came close and she could not believe what she saw. Anansi, her husband. Anansi, you died. What's happened? Anansi,
my wife, please release me here and I will tell you the truth.
You want to tell me the truth? You lie. And because of you, we spiders have to be ashamed for the rest of our lives. So people, that's why. Till up today, the spiders are always hiding at the corners of the houses. That's the reason why they're hiding. They feel ashamed. So if a spider is in your house, hiding somewhere at the house or under your bed, then you know exactly why this happening. Yeah. Thank you. A sip of water. So the next story, it's also an old Sufi story, a beautiful story. And the story is called Yasmina. Oye bambaleji, alati bambabu jang yu. Bambaleji, alati bambabu jang yu. Bujang Sankaranka, the beautiful girl Yasmina Touré lived with her father Alhaji Yaya Touré. Yasmina Touré was so beautiful. Hey, she had almond-shaped eyes and a skin so soft. And the special thing about Yasmina was the shape of her body. Hey! If Yasmina walked down to the big market on the big road, the whole traffic got stuck. So it was the time where the young man strolling around the compound to have a look on Yasmina. Father, Yaya Touré, he realized that and he called his daughter. Yasmina, no, you know Yasmina, you are my beautiful daughter and I love you so much. And I like to protect you from bad things. I like to protect you from evil things. And especially I like to protect you from men because men, they only want to have one thing from you. I will tell you how bad things can happen. First, the man, he will tell you how beautiful you are. And then, he likes to go out with you. And just by chance, you will pass his house.
There he will tell you he forgot his jacket there. And he will call you into his house. There he will serve you tea. And then he will put on beautiful music. And then, my daughter, he will jump on you and he will disgrace you. He will disgrace you, me, your mother, your father, your brothers, your sisters, and all our family. Yasmina Touré took the words of her father into her heart. And then about 2 weeks passed. After 2 weeks, Yasmina came to her father and she said, "La ilaha illallah Baba, are you a prophet? It was just exactly like you told me. I met a man and he said, how beautiful I am. And then he wants to go out with me. And just by chance, we pass his house. Beautiful house he got, Baba. And then he said he forgot his jacket and he called me into his house. There, as the tradition is, you serve me nice tea. And then he put on beautiful music, Baba. And then I thought about your words. And Baba, you know, you will see, I am your daughter. As I felt the moment is coming up, I jumped on him and I disgraced him. His mother, his father, his sisters, his brothers, and his whole family. Uh-huh. Be careful for your daughter. Thank you. Yes, beautiful. So, ladies and gentlemen, now we're coming to something where I need my brother again. Yes. Because, yeah, we're talking about that little drum here, you know, in West Africa, in the Mandi culture, we call it a tama. It's a tama talking drum. And so it's not so known in Zimbabwe. But, you know, it's one of the oldest drums in the planet, on the planet. It's called tama. And so we give you just a little something to feel how it is. Is a very beautiful story. The story is called Tishani.
Once upon a time, there was a little girl. Her name was Tishani. Tishani had a very hard life. Her parents died. And she had to live with her auntie. The name of her aunt was Kanku. Kanku was a bad person. A woman who grumbled all the time about everything. She gave everybody a hard life. Kanku was not a good person. Her heart was cold. Tijani had to work so much. Every day she had to clean up the compound. She has to wash the dishes. She has to wash all the clothes, and not with a wash machine. She had to do it with her hand. Every day, she had to go to the river and collect the water on a big basket, taking it home to the compound. That little girl, Tishani, she worked so hard. One day, her aunt Kanku went to the forest to collect firewood, as people in Africa have to do that. And she grumbled, as she do every time and all the time. This firewood is not nice. Tishani. She lives in my house, but she don't pay rent. She eats my food, but she don't pay for it. Tishani, that stupid little girl. The best thing would be if the devil takes her. You have to be careful for your thoughts, because your thoughts have the power to manifest, you know. And at that moment, Kanku said that a bony, skinny, short guy came out of the dark forest. And with one hand, he took the bundle of wood, put it on his head, whoop, and start to walk. Kanku behind, and she thought, okay, then I don't have to take that heavy bundle of wood home myself. Now good that this guy doing it. And when they arrive at the compound, the little bony skinny guy just threw the bundle of wood to the ground and he looked at Kanku's face. So Kanku knew that the guy would expect something. And she said, you know, here in this pot, there's food. It's 2 days old, but you can eat that. The bonus guy, he just shaked his head. He did not like that. So Kanku said, you see the tree? There's a trouser just lying there. It looks better than the one you have. So you can take that trouser. But the bony, skinny little guy, he just shaked his head. And then he had an idea. Kanku had an idea. She said, listen, in my compound here, there's a little girl. Her name is Tishani. Every day, she goes to the river to get the water there. And in the evening, when it gets dark, you just go there and you take her into the deep, dark forest. I will put her on a red dress. And you know, if you see the girl with the red dress, you just take her to the deep forest. That was the first time the bony, skinny little guy smiled. Tijani was in her room and she heard everything what they were saying. And her little heart started to beat fast. And she started to cry. And in the morning when she saw a red dress beside her bed, she knew exactly the plan of her aunt.
But what she can do, she's just a little girl. You know, she put on the red dress and she cried. And then she walked to the river. It was about 3 kilometers she had to walk to the river, a long distance. And she cried the river, going to the river. And when she arrived there, her friends asked, Tijani, why are you crying? And Tijani told her friends, Tijani, you know we are smart children. We might find a solution. And in the evening, when Tijani had to go to the river again with her red dress, she cried the whole way. And when she arrived there, all the children were dressed in red. Tijani started to smile. At that moment, the bony, skinny, short guy came out of the dark forest. And now he could not recognize Tijani because all the children were dressed in red. And he looked, and he looked, and he said, who's Tijani? All the children start to sing. I, Tijani, you, Tijani, we, Tijani, Tijani too, Tijani too, Tijani too. I, Tijani, you, Tijani, we, Tijani, Tijani too. The bony guy got really angry. He ran to the compound to Kanku, and he just wants to beat up Kanku, and Kanku just could calm him down, and she said, listen, tomorrow, I will put her on a yellow dress. It will work. You will see, it will work. So the short guy, he just calmed down. But at the next morning, when Tijani saw a yellow dress beside her bed, she knew exactly the plan of Kanku. But she was just a little girl. She lost hope. She put on that yellow dress and then she went to the river. She was going so slow, like a turtle. And when she arrived there, she cried. And her friend said, Tijani, why are you crying? And Tijani told his friends. And the friend said, Tijani, you know, we are smart, we will find a solution. And in the evening, when Tijani had to go again to the river with the yellow dress, she cried again, a river going to the river. And when she arrived there, all the children dressed in yellow. At that moment, the bony skinny guy came out of the forest, and now he could not recognize Tijani because all the children dressed in yellow. And he looked. Who is Tijani? And all the children start to sing. I, Tijani, you, Tijani, we, Tijani, Tijani too, Tijani too. Tijani too, I Tijani, you Tijani, we Tijani, Tijani too, Tijani too, Tijani too, I Tijani, you Tijani, we Tijani, Tijani too. The bony, skinny guy became really angry. And he ran to the house for Kanku, and he just wants to beat up Kanku. And just shortly before he gives Kanku a slap, Kanku could calm him down and say, tomorrow, you know, tomorrow, I will put her a purple dress on. You know, nobody in the village has a purple dress. I know that. None of the children will have a purple dress. and at the next morning when Tijani saw a purple dress beside her bed, Layla, hey, Layla, she lost all the hope. Because she knew none of the children will have a purple dress. And at this day, she walked slow like a turtle to the river. And she cried a river to the river. Her heart was beating so fast that she almost could stand it. You know, her heart was beating too fast. And when she arrived at the river, she cried. And her friend said, Tijani, why you cry again? And Tijani told her friends, everybody bent their head. A purple dress. They knew. They don't have a purple dress. And in the evening, when Tijani had to go again to the river, she lost all her hope. Her heart was beating so fast that she thought she'd die on the way. And she cried a river to the river, and when she arrived there, all the children were dressed in purple. And Tijani asked, how did you do that? And the children said, Tijani, you know, we are smart. We all have a white dress. And we went to the forest and collect berries. And with these berries, we just changed our white clothes into purple. At that moment, the bony, skinny guy came out of the dark forest. And he looked. Children. He looked for Tijani. But now he could not recognize Tijani because all the children dressed up in purple. And the guy said, who is Tijani? All the children start to sing, I Tijani, you Tijani, we Tijani, Tijani too, Tijani too. Tijani tu, I Tijani, you Tijani, we Tijani, Tijani tu, Tijani tu, Tijani tu, I Tijani, you Tijani, we Tijani, Tijani tu, Tijani tu, Tijani tu, I Tijani, you Tijani. The bony, skinny guy became now really angry. It's the third time Kanku fooled him. Yeah. And he ran to the compound. And he ran into the compound. And out of nowhere, he finally had a bag in his hand, and he put it over Kanku's head. He put the whole ant into the bag, and he closed the bag, and this heavy bag he put like nothing on his shoulder, and he started to walk into the dark forest. And from that day on, nobody ever saw the bony, skinny, short guy, and nobody ever saw the bad auntie Kanku. Tijani took over the compound from her aunt. And, you know, she set up everything beautiful. She invited all her friends every day. And, you know, Tijani and her friends, they lived a very good life for the rest of their lives. Tijani and her friends. Thank you. Golden apple. And in this apple, there was written, give this apple to the one you love the most. And the king gave the apple to the queen. The queen took the apple and she looked what was written and she gave the apple to her lover. The lover took the apple and look what was written there. And he gave the apple to the kitchen maid. The kitchen maid took the apple, look what was written there, and she gave the apple to the king. And the king wondered. So, give me a trumpet. Thank you. So the last important story, it's a very important story for the last one, you know, because this story is a long time. I'm telling this story and I'm learning myself from that story because, you know, that's a story for everyone. And think about it. It was time for the Jeliba to go to the market. The Jeliba, he went to the market, and there he saw the businessman Bombola selling a chicken for 5,000 dalasi. A chicken for 5,000 dalasi? That's impossible, it's too much money. And Bombola, standing there, shout to the people, chicken, 5,000 dalasi, 5,000 dalasi, a chicken, 5,000 dalasi. A big crowd surrounded him. Chicken, 5,000 dalasi. Then the Jeliba came and he said, Bombola, huh? How you can sell a chicken for 5,000 dalasi? What this chicken is able to do? This chicken here, this chicken, it can speak, it can talk. The Jeliba ran home. He took his turkey. He came back to the market and set himself up on the other side. And he started to shout to the people, turkey, 10,000 dalasi, 10,000 dalasi, turkey, turkey, 10,000 dalasi, 10,000 dalasi, turkey, turkey, 10,000 dalasi. The whole crowd who surrounded the Bombola turned around and went over to the Jeliba. Turkey, 10,000 dalasi, 10,000 dalasi, turkey, turkey, 10,000 dalasi. The Bombola went to the Jeliba and he said, Jeliba, mom, how you can sell a turkey for 10,000 dalasi? What this turkey is able to do? This turkey here, he can listen. Thank you for listening. Ladies and gentlemen, Vengai Manyanga, all the way from Zimbabwe.
Kunda Jobarteh.
Yeah, thank you, Shane. Thank you so much. Thank you, Shane. Thank you, Shane. So, greetings and blessings all the way from Munich. MUHAG!
MUHAG!
Servus! Thank you.